distance and all that kind of stuff, make sure you do what's necessary, because it is an order. You know, I want y'all to know that there's a lot of people that's doing a lot of different things. I mean, believe it or not, to a degree, it's almost as if the Lord even tells us to practice social distance from a perspective, because he says, lay hands on no man suddenly. That means you gotta be careful. You gotta really be led of the Spirit when it comes down to just doing and carrying out what it is that the Lord is calling us to do. But man, it's just, like I said, it's just awesome to have every one of you here and to actually be in a position where we can say, man, it's good to praise the Lord, man. I'm interested too, Minister Sokola, just like you said, on being able to find out, man, what is it that praise really do to us? So I welcome all of y'all to be here, everyone that joins in with us. Amen. Father, I just thank you right now, Lord God, for your word. I choose to honor you right now, Lord God, and we magnify you, Lord God, even during this season, Lord God, of the Passover, oh God.
Yes, Father God.
Father, we honor you right now, Lord Jesus, because your word says that you forgave us of our sins, Lord God. You redeemed us, Lord God. You gave us atonement, Lord God. You covered us, Lord God. And Father, we honor you right now, Lord God, because you look beyond our faults, Lord God.
Yes, Father God.
And you still saw our needs, Lord God. So Father, we just thank you right now, Lord God. And I pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you would encourage your people on tonight, Lord God, that we may rise and do what it is that you're calling us to do, Lord God. We choose to bless your most holy and your most righteous name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So y'all, come on, y'all. Give God a hand clap for praise. And praise the Lord. If you have your word, why don't you turn with me to the book of Colossians. Book of Colossians. Hallelujah. The book of Colossians, chapter 1. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's a couple of places that we're going to go tonight that we may receive this word, that we may digest this word, that we may proclaim this word. God has anointed us for a season just like this one. Everybody say, I was anointed for a season just like this. Called for a season just like this. Colossians 1. And I'm going to read just about 4 verses real quick. But then I'm going to try to get a couple of you to actually read our main focal verse. Praise the Lord. Colossians 1, verse 19. Y'all listen to this real carefully. Listen to this. For it pleased the Father that in him, Christ, should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. Y'all remember we was talking about that dual citizenship. Whether or not things on earth or things in heaven. Verse 21. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. Hallelujah. Verse 22, in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable, hallelujah, and unreprovable in his sight. Verse 23, if you continue in the faith, hallelujah, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Ooh, boy. Which you have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Minister Cole, I want you to go ahead and read that verse number 21 again. Read it loud from the man of God. Colossians 1 and 21. Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. We look at this son and see the God who cannot be seen. Am I on the right track?
No, Colossians 1 and 21. You got that, Terrence?
Yes, sir.
Colossians 1 and 21.
Hallelujah.
Wait.
And you, that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now have he reconciled.
Yet now have he reconciled.
Hallelujah.
Children, why don't you go ahead and read that same one, man? Read verse 21. Read it loud, man.
And you, that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now have he reconciled.
Reconciled. Hallelujah. Well, Frenchie, why don't you go read that 21 also, man?
And you who once were living in and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, that is it.
Wow. Look what he says, y'all. He says, and you who were sometimes alienated and enemies. Everybody say, at one point, I was an enemy of God. But guess where you were an enemy? In your mind. In your mind. There's certain things that we've done in this life, certain things that we were privy to, certain things that we were exposed to.
Hallelujah.
And these things had an effect on our minds. Believe it or not, we got to a place where we begin to think certain thoughts. And we begin to think certain things that we could do that would bring us pleasure. Things that did not have anything to do with God, but it was about temporary gain. Temporary fulfillment. Y'all know how it is. Y'all know how we do. We do things and we think that it's all in the name of fun. It's amazing to think that what we call fun right now, we dance and we say that's fun. We talk and we say that's fun. And we got words that come out of our mouth that's speaking death over ourselves. And yet we say, hey, ain't this fun? Aren't we having a good time? We have fun and we start drinking alcohol. Start being distorted in our minds. We get loaded. We smoke and we say, ooh, this is fun. Not realizing that we're opening gateways. Did you even know where that word alcohol comes from? You ought to look up that word alcohol. It comes from an ancient word called alcohol, which actually means a spirit. You ever thought about when you go to a place, if you have that, prayerfully, none of us are actually led to have to go there, but when you go to an alcohol place, a place where they serve alcohol, where they sell alcohol, you ever thought about why they call it wine, beer, and spirits? Spirits. You know, I used to think, when I was young, coming up, I used to think spirits meant, you know, just bubbly, just having a good time, until I found out what that word alcohol meant. Spirits actually means exactly what it sounds like. Spirits. Because believe it or not, there's different concoctions of drinks that can be mixed together. And it will cause and be guaranteed to cause some type of effect in your life. Some people say, I can't sleep. They'll show you a mixed drink that you can give them. That'll make you go to sleep. Some people say, I'm sleeping too much. They'll give you a drink to wake you up. They'll give you a drink when you feel depressed. They'll give you a drink to pick you up. They'll give you a drink to slow you down. Because what we don't understand is there's so many different spirits that come from alcohol that it's too much to even name the effects and how many different ones they have, so we can all sum it up by just saying spirits.
Wow.
It's important for us to know, because the word of God says my people perish because of a lack of knowledge. We don't understand why there's so many different things that happen in our lives. And these things, even though we think we're having fun, believe it or not, is making us think that we're enemies of God. Making us think that we can't do what we're supposed to do. Making us believe that we got to be in bondage to certain things that we thought was fun. Isn't that amazing? You got to do something because it's fun. Isn't it amazing that we talk about some of the biggest sins, some of the biggest shortcomings that's most popular or extremely addictive? Just like that little three-letter word. That three-letter word, sex. Do you realize that sex is one of the most effective, if not the most effective way to cause spirits to transfer? Because at this particular time, the Bible says if a man becomes one with a harlot, he becomes one. It's almost like sex, y'all, believe it or not, is a type of marriage. Sex is a type of commitment where you say, I'm willing to become one with you. And whatever that person is dealing with, you take it upon yourself. Yeah, and whatever you're dealing with, you're giving it to them. Scary, to the degree that even children are born that look just like you. Just like you. And now we're thinking, well, let's just make it popular. Let's just talk about prophylactics. Let's just talk about condoms. You know, it's amazing that rather than teaching the significance of this, we'd rather kill children. Isn't that amazing? Come on, y'all, let's think about it. Do y'all have any idea how many children are being killed every day? Praise the Lord. And we're thinking that we're having fun, but the scripture says right here, and some of the things, I like the fact it didn't say all the time. It said sometime you were alienated and enemies in your mind. What made us enemies? By wicked works. What's wicked? Everything that the Lord says is not righteous. By wicked works. Yet now had he reconciled us. He brought us together. Hallelujah. Verse 22 says, in the body of his flesh through death. That means that if you have a desire and a longing to be in the things of God, it didn't come without a fight. See, we got to understand that some people can come to God at a particular moment in time and others can't come at that same moment in time. Wow. So you got to begin to understand, what is this moment in time right now that God is drawing me by his spirit? I need you to understand that this. I saw somebody post something that said something like churches are going to start suffering and falling away. That people, because now they're going into the social media age where people church hop and they're talking like they're going to different churches, like they're going to different clubs. As if this is now going to dominate the need to even go to a church. But I need you to understand, when the scripture says to forsake not the assembling of ourselves together, there is a level, hallelujah, there is a level of anointing, there is a level of breakthrough that you get when you gather together in his name.
Hallelujah.
That's why he says if two or three, see a lot of times we just hear the two or three, but we don't hear the touch, hallelujah, and agree concerning anything. In order to touch, I got to get close to you. I got to be able to understand that there's some things about you that agree with some things about me, but it can't be perverted. Don't you know sometimes they got some people that join together and God had a spiritual purpose that he was trying to bring forward, but because you were so carnal, because you were so worldly, you took something that was supposed to be a blessing. And now you got people can't even speak no more. You got parents of children that can't even talk to one another. And their children are watching the fact that my mama don't even like my dad. You think that don't have an effect on a child? Praise the Lord. So these things attack children where, y'all? In your mind. And now you're wondering why marriage is not popular anymore. It's a mind thing, y'all. Certain things that look like it worked in the mind, certain things look like it didn't work in your mind. So Jesus said, now, in order for me to do something about this, he said, Father, you need a body that's going to be willing to go through something. So that we can be, everybody said, Lord, thank you for reconciling me.
Thank
you. Yo, this ain't nothing like, yo. This is something so important. Look, the Bible says that you were enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now had he reconciled, y'all, but we got so much to cover. Verse 22 says, in the body of his flesh through death, because of his death, y'all, I need y'all to really, there's a lot of other things that we got in our mind, but I got something you need to get this in your mind right here. Through his death, made it possible to present us not just alive, but holy. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all, think about some of the stuff that you did before. You know, there got some things that you know you did just yesterday that you say that wasn't too holy. So how powerful was his death that when you show up, because he told you that he don't see what you just did yesterday. Well, I'm going to show y'all some stuff. It's so very important for us to know who we are.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He said to present you holy, not only holy, y'all, unblameable. Y'all get that in your mind. Everybody say, I am holy right now.
I am holy right now.
Watch this, y'all. Everybody say, I am unblameable.
I am unblameable.
That means that there's a place in God where you may say, man, I feel so bad. Like, Lord, I can't come to you. You saw what I just did yesterday? And the Lord is like, no. I don't see what you did yesterday. But do you know the thoughts I just had? He says right here, y'all, unblameable. So if we constantly blaming ourselves, it's because the blame is not coming from the Father, but in our minds. Hallelujah. He says, unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. Oh my God. If, here we go, y'all, verse number 23. If you continue in the faith, I know you got some things that's stopping you and some things that's hindering you, but that's why the scripture says that we must lay aside every weight and everything that easily besets us. He says that if you continue in the faith, look what he says, y'all. Grounded and settled. Like, make yourself stop focusing on your mistakes and start focusing on where you're supposed to be going.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
It's not, that's why he says, look what he says, look how he says, forgetting those things that are behind you and pressing forward toward the mark of the call, of the high call, which is in Christ Jesus. And look what he says. You might be saying, well, I know I got some more temptations coming, but guess what? Look what he says. And be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Don't be moved away from the hope of the gospel. Everybody say, Lord, I put my hope in you right now. I put my hope in you right now, Lord God. He says, which you have heard and which was preached to every creature under heaven. And Paul says, he made me a servant. He made me a minister. Praise the Lord. Y'all, as we prepare to close out, praise the Lord, there is a place that we have to go real quick right now, and it's found in the book of Jeremiah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And y'all, it's Jeremiah chapter 50, but I need you to understand. I need you to be able to say, Lord, please pass over my mind. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Pass over my mind, Lord God. Pass over my mind, Lord God. Y'all, so I don't know about y'all, but sometimes we think some wicked thoughts, y'all. Sometimes thoughts come, we don't know where they came from, and all of a sudden we start wishing that we can have certain things, and then we're like, oh, Lord, I'm not even supposed to be thinking about that. And not even moments later, you go back to it again. So that means that I need the Lord to pass over my mind. What do you mean when you say pass over your mind? You know, the scripture says that when Moses led the children of Israel through the Red Sea, before he got to the place where he led them through the Red Sea, the Passover had taken place in Egypt already. So that means that before they got a chance to start taking a journey to get ready for the wilderness, God had to already show them, I'm going to protect you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to watch over you. I'm going to be your hedge. I'm going to be your strong tower. So now, in the midst of all these different plagues that come through, one of the last ones that the Lord had to show his people that I'll protect you from is the spirit of death. The spirit of death. And in the midst of the stuff that the people of God were doing, God gave Moses instructions. He said, I need you to take an innocent lamb, apply the blood over the doorpost. And look what he says, it doesn't matter what you've done. I just need you at this time, come on in the house. Come on in the house. All the fathers, all the heads of the households, make them come inside the house. And I really want to tell you all something right now, because I want y'all to be careful with your socializing right now. I want you to be careful, not because something is wrong with socializing, but the Bible says that there was a people called the children of Issachar. And they understood the times that they were living in. That means that there's a time to play, but then there's a time to refrain from playing. Wow. You know, we got to get to a place where we begin to understand that God makes us discerners of the time, so that we know what we're supposed to do at the right time. Is this making sense to you?
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. So that means that this is bringing us to a place where we become more God conscious. Lord, I want to hook up with that boy, Minister Coleman, right now. But is this the right time? Y'all, we literally want to get to a point to where we begin to pray before we do certain things. Begin to invite the Lord into your life. Because guess what? If you say, Lord, I want to go by my girlfriend, but Lord, should I go? Guess what's going to happen? All of a sudden, your patterns and your cycles of the things that you used to do is going to come to mind.
Oh, yes, sir.
And it's going to make you realize, is this really a good time for you to go? Are you strong enough to go? Are you able to say that little small word? It's only two letters, y'all. Can you say no?
No.
Praise the Lord. So when we understand that we need this Passover in our mind, we have to get it in our mind that we are chosen by God. We have to get in our mind that we are royal priesthood. We are chosen generation.
Hallelujah.
We got to understand, y'all, just because there's songs that's popular don't mean that you're supposed to be speaking these words into your psyche, into your mind, into your soul. That old popular song that's out right now is always in my mind talking about I'm a savage and I'm nasty. Think about it. It's a popular song, but do you really want me? Come on, y'all, think about it. If you really saw what a beast looked like, a real beast, a savage beast, would you be like, ooh, I want to marry that?
Oh, no.
I want to be with that. Nah, because you got to understand, there's certain things that we're speaking that's trying to make us one with other entities so that it can use us to fulfill its mission.
Oh, Lord.
And you wonder why the Bible, why the scripture says that life and death is in your tongue? You wonder why we got to have on the helmet of salvation to guard your mind? I'm going to tell you something. It's going to take some warriors to say, man, I used to be cussing all the time, but man, I'm about to start scaling back.
Oh, hallelujah.
Man, I used to be saying some things that I knew I always wanted, but you know what? I'm about to take it a step further. I used to let my partners talk like this in front of me, even refer to me like that, but I'm about to start saying, sit down. I mean, you know, I know we're different, but I don't want you to talk to me like that, man. Want me to tell you what's going to happen? That means if you start doing that, you're going to start getting a chance to see how much your friends have that word that all men want, respect. Just because they wish you don't mean they respect you. Sometimes they respect you as long as you're doing what they want you to do. Because at the time when you do it, guess what? You're an enemy of God.
What?
Hallelujah. Everybody say, pass over my mind.
Pass over my mind.
Hallelujah. Y'all know how we do? Y'all know how we do? Boy, this is so powerful. Oh my God, oh my God. We have to get it in our minds who we are. Ask God to start giving you a mind and make some confessions over your life. That you wake up in the morning saying, I'm a son of righteousness. I'm a son of royalty. I'm a daughter of integrity. Get it in your mind. Begin to get it in your mind saying, I will not be afraid of terror by night. Nor will I be afraid of the terror that flies by day. Why? Because my habitation is in him. Hallelujah. I live in him. I move in him. I have my very being in him. And guess what, y'all? In him, you won't find fear. If you get in him, there is no fear. God said, I didn't give you the spirit of fear.
Hallelujah.
But power, love, and a sound mind.
Glory.
Everybody say, Lord, put it in my mind. Let me get it in my mind. How do I get it in my mind? It's just like saying how you put French fries in your stomach. You know, that's like looking, boy, they got this little spot out here called Tornado Burger. I don't know how many of y'all had Tornado Burger, man. Boy, that Tornado Burger go off, boy. It's got the ground meat. It's got jalapenos blended in with the meat. They ask you if you want spicy or regular. I'm telling you, it is nice. But you know what? No matter how good I know it is, no matter how much I know, it's a pleasurable experience. But if I never get a chance to take a bite of it and get it in me, I'ma just be looking at it. Talking about, boy, I know that thing probably tastes good. Let me tell y'all something. The word of God is powerful. You'll be talking about, man, my grandfather, man, my daddy. Man, I know this pastor. I know he's serious. You know, you'll be always a bystander looking at, look at what he did. And look at, man, God did this with him. God, why don't you try eating it?
Hallelujah.
Why don't you put it in your mouth? Why don't you not just eat it? How about you digest it? Let it get in you. Let it live in you. I know what's wrong with some of y'all scared. Because if he live in you, some of them chicks that you deal with, they won't deal with you no more.
Real talk.
Some of the partners that you think you real cool with them. Yeah, you cool. You cool, but you let that word get on the inside of you. Some of them friends gonna start backing away from you, saying, man, we was about to go such and such, and we was about to invite you, Emmanuel. Hallelujah. We was about to invite you, but we can't because we'll have God with us. So I can't invite you, I can't bring you with me. And you know what's gonna start happening? Then you gotta endure that wilderness. Hallelujah. You got to endure the wilderness. What God says, yeah, it may take 3 years before you get a solid friend. But can you walk with me for 3 years?
Jesus' name.
Can you walk with me? Y'all, I'm trying to hurry up. I'm trying to hurry up. Oh, my God. Can you walk with me? Can you walk with me? Praise the Lord. Can you walk with me? Can you walk with me? Minister Sokola, I wasn't even going to tell you this, man. I was saying to myself, I told you, Mom, I wasn't going to tell you. I wasn't going to tell you, man. I wasn't going to tell you, but I got to tell you. When you was up here, man, and everybody was dancing, and everybody was all hype, a tear came to my eye, man, because I remembered how lonely you used to be.
Sweet.
For real.
I'm telling y'all what I know. Loneliness is a wilderness. So when minister is dancing with y'all, telling y'all, hey fellas, y'all come on, stand up. See, there's certain things you ain't gonna get unless you learn how to walk alone. Because you'd be too afraid of wondering what the other person gonna say about you. But when God delivers you, you get to a place where you say, Father, what you want me to do? And if they need me, I know how they feel already. Long as you don't need me. Girl.
Hallelujah.
So if the Lord told me, minister, a tear came to my eye. He said, I didn't just give you a son. He said, I gave you a general.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
I'm going to tell y'all something. It's important for us to know who we are. And I need all of you to know, you all are a royal generation.
Hallelujah.
You're a holy nation, a royal priesthood. Y'all are kings.
Hallelujah.
And priests. Stop being afraid of letting somebody know your royalty. Let your walk change. That's the way you were supposed to walk. Let your talk change. Stop putting your seed in these women that God said that's not somebody I assigned to you.
Yes. Yeah.
That's the hard truth.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Look what he says right here, y'all. This is what we're closing out. God says in Jeremiah 50, verse number 19. Is this making sense to everybody?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Glory to God.
Jeremiah 50, 19. Look what he says right here. Y'all, this is so heavy. This is so heavy. Y'all, you're going to love this, Sister Allie. He says, and I will bring Israel again to his habitation. Habitation is a place where you live.
In the name of Jesus.
Y'all know sometimes we leave where we live. God said, I'm going to let you go through some things so I can bring you back where you live. Look what he says. And he shall, what y'all Bible say right there? He shall do what?
Feed.
Feed. In other words, you're going to eat.
Hallelujah.
Look what he says. You're going to eat on Carmel and Bashan. Mm. And his soul shall be satisfied upon Mount Ephraim and Gilead. Now, y'all, we could just run through this if we wanted to, but watch this, y'all. I said, Lord, these are four different mountains. What do they mean? Y'all, when we was in here, y'all was praising. I said, well, let me go ahead and look it up real quick and say, what does this mean? Y'all, when he says, my people are going to feed on Carmel. Carmel means a fruitful place. Fruitful. Like, you're going to eat where when you eat it, it's going to make you fruitful. See, a lot of times, y'all, when we enemies in our mind, it's because of what you've been eating. You keep doing the wrong things because of what you've been eating. God says, come on back over here. Eat right here. I need y'all to understand, y'all, right now. I know we on 1730 Staffordshire, but believe it or not, right here we're in a high place. We're on one of his mountains right now, y'all. Watch this, y'all. He says you're going to feed on Carmel, which is fruitful. But guess what Bashan means? Bashan says it means fruitful also. God said, yeah, you're going to go over here? Yeah. You're going to produce some fruit. Guess what? Wait a minute, I want to go over there on Bashan. He said, you know what? That's a good place to go to. You're going to produce even more fruit. Even more fruit. God said, guess what? I know you're like, man, every time I go by this girl house, I feel like my mind get messed up. Every time I buy this, my partner house, I leave and I'm always doing wrong stuff. He said, it was the wrong mountain top. He said, come to this one. He said, I'll perhaps give you another house you can go to. You know, I'll send you to Minister Sokola, praise the Lord, on Carmel. Oh, I'll send you by Terrence on Bashan. Watch this, y'all. They got another one right here, y'all. The next one is called Ephraim, Mount Ephraim. Everybody say Mount Ephraim.
Mount Ephraim.
Yo, guess what Ephraim means? It means fruit also, but guess what it means? Double fruit. Double the fruit. Now that means what it may take one person so much time to do one thing, you do it twice. It takes one person enough time to learn how to maybe get one scripture in their mind and you didn't memorize the whole chapter. It get one person to get enough courage to be able to say their grace when they hear it and eat their food. Y'all, believe it or not, you got to grow to a place to be able to openly bless your food. And while one person blessing his food, the other one is ready to stand on top of the table and preach the gospel.
Ooh-wee.
Double fruit. And I'm not going to ever give y'all the unbalanced gospel because the word is not unbalanced. But guess what Gilead is? Gilead is the one that we're afraid of, y'all. Gilead is rocky. It's dangerous. Some relationships you go through, guess what? You got to go through the rocky times to see what's on the inside of you. You're going to be tested. He says, I'm going to bring Israel because you know what? Y'all are not weak. God said, my people are not obese people that's not functioning and not fruitful. God said, my people in shape. So I got to give you some rocky places. Build up your muscles. Make you start understanding who you are. Make you start getting some strength. He said, sometime I'm going to leave you there to see how strong you to pull yourself out of the mess. Everybody say Gilead.
Gilead.
Praise the Lord. Last verse, y'all. Verse number 20. Ooh, boy. In those days and in that time, look, after you done came from Carmel and Bashan and after you done went through Ephraim, double blessing. Everything was double. Hallelujah. Then you come through Gilead. God said, I got to let you go through Gilead. You got to know what it means to have some dangers, some trials, some testing. Look what he says. In those days, verse 20, and in that time, said the Lord, when you mature, look what he says, your iniquity is going to be looked for. People are going to be seeking for your iniquity. And look what the word says. And there shall be none. None. In other words, when you know how much wrong you feel like you've done, God says, I don't see nothing. God says there's going to be a time where people are going to be looking for your faults. God says, I'm going to say, what fault? Look what he says. And the sins of Judah, they shall not be found. Somebody talking about, man, you know what Bosco just did last year. God said, no, I don't. Where is it? Nobody will be able to find it. Everybody said, we're not an enemy anymore.
We're not an enemy.
He says, for I, y'all, listen to that last verse. That last verse is the most powerful when we're closing up the Bible. Not verse, but the last part of the sentence. For I will pardon them who I reserve.
God.
I will pardon them who I reserve. That means that you're chosen by God. God says, you know what? If I've chosen you, that's why the New Testament says, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? God say, I chose you. When I chose you, God say, I don't need none of your baby mamas, none of your ex-girlfriends. There's going to be certain things that God is going to be like, innocent. Man. You know why? Because you purpose in your heart to go to Carmel and to go to Bashan and to go to Ephraim. God says, oh yeah, I can blow your socks, I can blow your mind, I can bless your socks off. He said, but before you leave that place, come on, let's go to Gilead.
Amen.
Let's go to Gilead. See what it feels like when that person you thought that loved you, all of a sudden, now that you're changing, you all excited and you ready to tell them and share the word with them. They're looking at you like, what are you talking about? I ain't down with all that. You're going to start finding out who's really controlling those people who you with.
Tell the truth.
Who's controlling them? Praise the Lord. God says, look, we've been talking about the Passover because it was a death angel that came. All these people died. And God said, but I preserved you. God says, I will pass over your flaws. I said, I will pass over your wrongs. Matter of fact, look what the Lord says. He said, I will pass over you and be like, what wrong? You're perfect in my sight. Y'all know what it is. Come on, let me make it a little bit more plain. When two people decide to get married, it don't mean that they don't have flaws. Most of the time, if you find a young lady that you want to meet, you already, if you know somebody that know, you already call them, man, tell me something about it. What's going on? Give me the DL on it. When people get married, a lot of time they did all kind of research. And if they find out, yeah, she was with this one, that one, or he was with this one, this one, this one, it's something in that person that says, I don't care. I still want her. See, in order for us to understand the love that God has for us, you got to understand, God says, look at what you do. God says, are you trying to say that she don't do no wrong? You're like, no, but I still want her. God says, I still want you.
Hallelujah.
God says, but come here. God says, it's easy for me to sweep you off your feet. He said, you don't know how much caramel I got around you. I got Bashan all around you. Don't talk about Ephraim, boy. Everybody like that Ephraim. That's double-double. But the Lord said, I know you're running to Ephraim right now, but come here, I need to introduce you to Gilead.
Oh, hallelujah.
You got to be strong. Husbands got to know how to be strong for their families.
Yes.
Wives got to know how to be strong for their children. You got to know. Guess what? Let me make it plain a little bit more, y'all. We done right here. A teacher even knows how to deal with this. Because a teacher can tell a whole class. Everybody could be acting a fool most of the time. And the teacher say, you know what? I'm going to help y'all out and I'm going to drop your lowest grade. Oh, yeah. What is he saying? I'm going to pass over your worst mistake that you made.
My Lord.
Wait, you think that there could be a teacher in school? I can do it. You think a husband can choose to marry a wife choose to marry a husband, and you think God is not doing it? God says in the book of Isaiah, he says, I'm your husband. He said, now watch you commit adultery on me. He said, yet return unto me, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Every one of us, y'all, would not escape judgment. I need y'all to understand that the Son has the authority to forgive. Christ, he has authority to forgive. That's why it says, if you come unto me, all you who are weary, you're tired, you feel like you got more Gilead than Ephraim, say, come see me. Come see me. Let me give you some rest. God says, I have the authority, and guess what? He says, I give you the authority to forgive. Everybody, just take a moment and forgive everybody that hurt you. Everybody that just right now to yourself, just begin to think about anybody you think about that hurt you. Fall down, forgive right now, Lord God. Forgive them right now. What are you doing when you forgive? You're passing over. Hallelujah. Choose to overlook. Choose to give a pardon. And like they say in the world, I give you a pass. I'm going to let you ride. I'm going to give you a pass. So Father, right now, I just thank you right now, Lord God, for building up our minds right now, Lord Jesus. I thank you for forgiveness right now, Lord God. I thank you so much, Lord God. I thank you so much, Lord God. I appreciate, Lord God, Carmel. I appreciate Bashan. Yes, thank you, Lord God, for Ephraim, Lord God. But most importantly,